And we segue into Freddie Coleman, who joins us every Friday morning right here on Big Board Sports at 10:30, part of the Freddie and Fitz on ESPN Radio 11 to 2 Eastern. I listen to it on my way home every single night, Monday through Friday. Good morning, Freddie.
Good morning, Roger, and I appreciate that because I've been looking for that one person that does that outside of my family. I'm glad I found him in you.
I'm there. Say hello to me on the ride home, Freddie.
I will. I'm never going to do that one night. You got it, man.
So I kind of know, listening to your show last night, where you stand on Matty Ryan. You got into like a little MVP for midway through, which is a good topic, and you're going to definitely include Matt Ryan in that discussion, aren't you?
There's no doubt about that because I think you look at that offense right now, that is the best offense in the National Football League, where they've scored at least 40 points in three games, and no team in the NFL other than them has at least one more than one game of doing that. And I think for the first time in a while with Matt Ryan, we're starting to see what he's been able to do from a leadership standpoint. He's not going to be the kind of guy that's going to stand up and say, look at me, look at me. He wants his actions to speak louder than any words he could give or anybody else can give. But he just looks different this year in that offense. And he and Kyle Shanahan have done a tremendous job being a cohesive twosome to make that work. But if they keep this up and their defense will allow them to score a lot of points because they'll have to, we may start to hear more and more about that, and deservedly so for a guy that's been a terrific quarterback in the NFL for a minute.
Well, my partner, Freddie, Zachary Bye, would actually put him ahead of Tom Brady, and we've done nothing but rave about Brady since his return, but he did miss the first 4 weeks. Would you have Ryan ahead of Brady right now or not?
Right now I would have him ahead based on the fact that he has played more games, but I'll tell you this. Tom Brady continues to play like this, and he's completed 12 touchdown passes, has not thrown an interception, completing 75% of his passes. He continues to play like this, and let's say they only lose one game with him as a starting quarterback. You're going to hear that drumbeat get a lot louder for him, especially when he's more of a known quantity than Matt Ryan, and the Patriots that seemingly would have a better record. But it's going to be an interesting race between those two, and other people will be thrown in the mix. Ezekiel Elliott of Dallas, he keeps playing like this. You got to put his name in that conversation. If Derek Carr, the Oakland Raiders, they got a big-time game this weekend against Denver on national TV. If he goes out there and he dominates that defense, his name would jump into that conversation. So it's still early. There's no doubt about that. But I think those four guys right now are the leading candidates for the MVP in the NFL.
Hey, Freddie, my son Matt works in San Francisco, so he's about 3 hours behind where we are, on his way to work. He's a physical therapist. He's a huge Steeler fan. Sends me a text and goes, ask Mr. Coleman. See, he was brought up properly. Ask Mr. Coleman. I like that, Matt. Good job. What he thinks about the Steelers D against the Ravens this week.
Well, the Steelers defense, I think, will continue to improve, and they have to avoid the injury bug, and that goes with any National Football League team, but especially their unit, because there's not a lot of depth behind it that you can really quantify and say that guy can step in, we can plug and play him, and we're going to be okay. But the Steelers' best defense is going to be their offense, because when you have an offense that puts a lot of stress on opposing defenses, it also puts a lot of stress on opposing offenses because you have to keep up. So when Ben Roethlisberger comes back, we know what kind of offense this is going to be. They can do the same thing to other teams to help their defense, what we've seen with the Patriots have been able to do and the Atlanta Falcons have been able to do, and at times the Dallas Cowboys, but they've been able to do. When you have an offense that you know, okay, even if we give up 21, that offense is going to score 24 or more, that's the best kind of defense you can have no matter who you are. So I think the Steelers defense will continue to improve. When Roethlisberger comes back, that'll really help out their defense because it's hard to match that team in a firefight when that offense is running on all cylinders.
All right, there you go, Matt. I hope that answers your question from Mr. Coleman. Have a good day, and there we go. Got that one in from San Francisco. Now we go back to our regional teams of interest. Freddie Coleman with us every Friday on Big Board Sports. Do the Giants benefit from the bye week? Do they come out of the bye week and put up a, you know, play well at home and get a big win over Philadelphia on Sunday? Big game in the NFC East?
You would think they should, but as I've noticed, outside of teams coached by Andy Reid, there's always a sluggishness right at the beginning when a team comes out of a bye week. For whatever reason it is, it's just the nature of what goes on in the National Football League when you have that bye week. But I think the one thing that I hope the New York Giants, and put that in their favor, is you're playing a division opponent, the Philadelphia Eagles, who you know are going to be ornery after blowing a 10-point lead versus Dallas last Sunday. Number two, you can ill afford to have a loss right now, because if the Cowboys beat the Browns, and they should, the Browns are a winless team. You lose that game, you have at least a three-game deficit that you have to overcome against Dallas. And that's going to be hard to do that over the final eight games of the regular season. So if I'm the New York Giants, there's no way that I'm making sure that my team comes out sluggish, because if you do, then Philadelphia jumps on you. They take the crowd out of the game, and now you got a tough time dealing with them, especially in a division game. So it's going to be one of those typical NFC East matchups, but I think there'll be a lot more offense because of what the Giants offense has been able to do so far this year at times, even though it's been spotty. And Philadelphia, they can push the ball down the field a little bit, but weaken the Giants defense a little bit more. Also, you can have a game that could be 24-21, 27-24. But if you're the Giants, you cannot afford a slow start, especially with a division opponent. And now the Cowboys right now with a two-game lead over you in that division.
Freddie, I'm curious to what you think about Richard Sherman's quotes from, I think, just about 24 hours ago. It's kind of speaking out against the NFL and why the ratings are dropping. He said because the league isn't fun anymore. They've tried to take the personality away from players, and then while at the same time having Budweiser as, you know, the sponsor of the league when you're trying to set an example for kids. I'm curious what you thought of those comments and if there's any validity to them.
Well, there's validity to them, but I think the bigger factor where we see declining ratings, in my opinion, is that at times it's been bad football. Let's call it as it is. And I think a lot of that has to do with what we've seen on Thursday night, where we've seen a lot of bad football at that time of the week. And I've always wondered what was wrong with Sunday and Monday when it came to the National Football League. I think by having Thursday night football every Thursday, they've kind of taken the novelty factor, the wow factor out of their league. And then if you see a bad product on Thursday, invariably the average fan's going to say, oh my goodness, if that's bad on Thursday, why am I watching on Sunday? And also think this, when those storylines aren't there, and the storylines that were there in the offseason, people are tired of hearing about Deflategate. People are tired of hearing about Colin Kaepernick and players protesting against the American flag, whether you were strong for them or strong against them. The NFL has always been a big thing about the play on the field that's going to supersede everything else. And at times, there's been bad football. Now, I think the best thing that could have happened for the NFL was we had a game on Sunday night, in which was the highest-rated Sunday game of the season. You had the Cowboys and the Eagles. You had two teams that people knew about. And now you got a chance to see a Dak Prescott and Carson Wentz. You start having more of those games, and you start having Tom Brady play like he's been able to play. Maybe Matt Ryan gets a little bit more love. When Ben Roethlisberger comes back for the Steelers, all of a sudden they start rolling downhill. You start seeing a better product on the field, then the fans are going to gravitate towards it. Prime example, look at the World Series. The more and more that World Series went along, the better the games were. And what happened? We had 40 million people watching Game 7 between the Cubs and the Cleveland Indians on Wednesday. You put out a better product, it's not going to matter what happened with the other storylines. If people want to see good football and the average person, the perception is that it's not there, then they're going to tune out no matter what else is going on.
Freddie, you want bad football, I'll show you the Jets. That's what I'll do. Show you the Jets. Jets and Browns.
Bad quarterback play, yes.
Oh, my goodness. All right, so the Jets, bad team. I don't think they're any good at all. They're going to Miami, and this Dolphins team been running the football here a little bit. What's your thoughts on Jets at Dolphins Sunday?
It all depends on that one guy, Ryan Fitzpatrick, because we saw the first half against Cleveland where he was just, in the words of Shaquille O'Neal, horror awful in the first half. And I'm thinking, this is Ryan Fitzpatrick. This is the essence of what he is. And then in the second half, he plays out of his mind, relatively speaking, and we saw the Jets were able to do to a winless team that they should have done at the beginning. And you're right about Miami running the football, because that helps out Ryan Tannehill. That helps out their defense. They're not playing as many plays. But this game comes down to Ryan Fitzpatrick. If he's playing well early, the Jets should not have a problem winning this game. If he goes 3-for-12, 3-for-14, like we saw in the first half against the Cleveland Browns, they won't be able to escape and win this game, because Miami has shown that if they get a lead, that running the football, although it's going to be hard to do that in the Jets front seven, they'll be able to take time off the clock and eat away at their defense and eat away at their offense. So Ryan Fitzpatrick, I hope for his sake, he's gotten over having his feelings hurt and being benched, and the Jets have won two in a row. He's got to go out there and not turn the football over and not make those kind of idiotic decisions that we've seen before. The Jets have, to me, they have too much talent to be a 3-5 team right now, even though they had a murderer's row of a schedule. But if he continues to be up and down, he's going to typify what the New York Jets have been all season long, but a lot more down than up when it comes to him and that team.
A little bit of up and down with Buffalo, too. They've now lost. Buffalo has now lost back-to-back games, Freddie, and they sit at 500. They're going to Seattle on Monday night. Has Buffalo lost its way, or is this a little bump in the road for Rex Ryan and the boys?
I don't know about lost its way because look who they lost to. You lose to the Patriots, there's no shame in that. We all called that one because with Captain America back in the lineup at quarterback and Tom Brady, you had to believe that if Buffalo didn't have an A++++ game, they were not going to beat them. And now they're playing another elite defense in the Seattle Seahawks on the road on Monday Night Football. And believe me, Seattle, after losing that game to the Saints, you know that their defense is going to say, yeah, we let that one get away. We're not going to let Buffalo come into our house and beat us on Monday Night Football. And Russell Wilson, people don't realize, he's having a terrific season despite being beat up and not having a consistent running game. If you're the Buffalo Bills, whatever players are injured or not playing well for you or hurt right now, you're going to need those guys in spades because that defense on the other side of Seattle, they are all over the place. They are fast. They are fierce. They are aggressive. And they love playing in front of a home crowd on Monday Night Football. So I don't know if Buffalo's lost their way. They've just run into better competition. And right now they don't have the personnel to match up with that better competition, what we saw in New England. And they better hope that gets better Monday night when they play Seattle.
Freddie, one more for me. Do you believe in the Raiders at all with Derek Carr and the numbers he put up certainly last week, over 500 yards? And can they beat the Denver Broncos Sunday night at home?
Well, I believe in them before the season started because I thought when they hired Jack Del Rio before last season, I thought that was a terrific hire because he was not going to put up with any nonsense. He was going to give it to the players straight. And if they didn't like it, he didn't care. He was going to put out the best guys in the football field. So I wasn't surprised to see him get the 7 wins last year. I thought they could get the 10 wins this year and make the playoffs. But I don't think anybody saw what we've been able to see from Derek Carr, even though I love the way that he plays with that edge because he believed he should have been drafted in the first round out of Fresno State. And when that didn't happen, he's been on this crusade to show people that he was worthy of being a first-round pick. But when you have a guy like that with that kind of ability, you need to give him home run hitters. And he has two in Amari Cooper and Michael Crabtree. So you know Oakland, they've been waiting for a game like this in that city for a long, long time, especially the Denver Broncos and that elite defense coming into their place. He has a chance, but I've seen that Denver defense that can turn around people really, really quickly. But Oakland's offense is so good that they can run the ball effectively. The offensive line is underrated, and Derek Carr is not going to make those big mistakes but take chances down the field. I think they have a chance. I still think Denver will go in there and get a win because I think they're a better football team. But Derek Carr and that offense will not make it easy on that outstanding Broncos defense.
Freddie Coleman, every Friday here on Big Board Sports Talking NFL Football. Freddie, thank you. Have a great weekend. We'll talk to you next Friday.
My pleasure, Roger and Zach. And Roger, tell your son hi. And also, anytime he wants to chime in, feel free.
Yeah, no problems there, Mr. Coleman. Take care.
<You too>.
Freddie Coleman every Friday on Big Board Sports.